targeted pharmacotherapy skills. So it's where students learn the skills that they need in order to be outcome assessed. And these are, students are performing skills, we provide them feedbacks using a lot of rubrics, and historically they've been very complex paper-based rubrics. And so I'll kind of talk to you in some future directions on where we're thinking about spring semester and using rubrics, but I wanted to spend some time today really talking about how I've used rubrics, some of the challenges that I've had with rubrics in Canvas, but also some of the kind of the workarounds that I've found as well. So I hope that you find it that helpful for you today. So first of all, before I even going into rubrics, I wanted to talk about how you can grade in a variety of ways and assess students in Canvas. And the reason why I'm kind of putting this as the background is that because in order to decide if you want to use a rubric and how you want to use a rubric, I think it's good to know what other options are available out there and how you might want to use one way or the other. I've used all of these ways before too, so if there's a question that you have about a comparison, please let me know. So the first one is just strictly points. Over here, this is something that kind of what it looks like in the grading screen and SpeedGrader. Probably all of you are familiar with, you can just go and add the points in out of that box in the upper right-hand corner. For comments, you can add comments directly, so you can see here assignment comments. That is just something that can be typed right in, and you can give that to a student, and the student is notified right away about those comments. And then the next one is rubrics. So in order to grade with a rubric, you would hit rubric, and then the rubric will pop up, and then you can choose however you want. This assignment was credit or no credit. And then the last way is feedback directly in assignment. I don't know if anyone here has seen that before, where you can actually have a Word document and write feedback. Have you guys seen that? Is everyone familiar? Some people, yes, some people no. Through SpeedGrader, yes. So if a student uploads a file and it's a Word document, you can actually provide feedback directly on the document here using a variety of tools in SpeedGrader with highlighting, with creating bullets. This is not a real class. This is a visual I found on the internet, so none of the students, you know, it's publicly available to everyone. No students in my course or anything like that. But this is just something that you can provide feedback. One thing to note, though, is that students won't know that you can make comments unless you put an assignment comment. I can kind of show what it looks like from the student later. Yeah?
They commented on their own? That student in the room?
Like I said, this is a freely available online.
I don't know if I've ever seen that.
And it's asking for their own feedback on this part, which is kind of a cool way to say, hey, instructor, here's my assignment.
I have not ever thought of that as an accessible option for students to really get into their own uploaded assignment.
And I didn't even know that, but the reason I did this is because I have used this before, and something historically that I've used a paper rubric for, and then used a paper rubric, and then this is how I would give the student the feedback, and then have to do the rubric grade separately. So the reason I'm kind of doing this is that if you do use this, is a rubric a better way for you when you're thinking about it? There's a question.
While we're going off straight, does the track changes work in Word if you open up a Word document like that or not?
So you can't make changes to the document itself. All you can do is add comments on the side.
If you're going to do that, the instructor needs to download the files. That will open it up in Word, and they can track it and re-upload it. So.
Yeah, but this is just kind of making comments and pointing to where exactly that comment is.
You can write on the document, but it's like another layer on top of that document of comments, of text that you can write, you can scribble, you can do all kinds of stuff on that document, but it's not actually, it's just a layer on top of that document that you're actually interacting with. So, like Cliff said, you have to download the document to make changes directly.
It's a really neat feature, but it also is kind of to see what if it would work for you or not. So the reason I kind of give all of this background is that when you're grading students, it really depends on what you want to do and what type of feedback you want to provide. So the rubrics, I've had a lot of experience from a really basic rubric, credit, no credit, a one-point assignment. Many of the assignments in my courses are credit or no credit, and then that's just more, it's just as a student did the assignment, we do provide some of those assignments with feedback, but it's just a way for us to keep track of that. But I also use some more complex assignments. So in the courses, the lab-based courses, the integrated pharmacotherapy skills courses, they're performance-based. And students are required to be professional and dress professionally and act professionally in those courses. And so this year we started grading them on their professionalism. And so this is a really extensive rubric on a variety of different things, from dressing professionally to wearing their like white coat. So I built this out in Canvas, and then also some of them have a longer description. So I don't want to have this massive description about what is all encompassed in here. Students have the paper, kind of a PDF version of what actually the rubric is, so they know what the expectations were. But you are able to actually make a longer description if you want to, but you have to click on that to see the, that longer description. That a pop-up window will come up for that. So this is another example of a really long rubric. Our rating scale here was either yes, they did it, no, they did not. So once again, rather simple. So how do you even start with some of these rubrics? And I'll get into some more examples of rubrics that we do use over at the School of Pharmacy in just a few slides. So this is just an example of an assignment. Over here, you would have on the very lower right button, see, that'd be the plus rubric. You click on that. The next thing that you would do is you would set up the rubric this way. And so this is kind of the basic screen. If you've never been in there before, how it has the description of the criterion, a longer description here, and then the marks in the center. So this is really how it kind of comes up to you. What I like to do is, for the ratings, it defaults to either marks, or full marks, or no marks. It's really helpful to determine how many marks you want to have. So if you're going to have two, or if you're going to have five, go ahead and add them all in before changing anything. Because sometimes it does get a little bit messed up if you do one and then want to flip it to a different area, and then it doesn't really want to add in where you want to add it in. So my recommendation is just if you have five, add five boxes, and then add everything in that way. You can change the number of points, you can change the titles or the headings on the ratings, and it's all editable by using the little pencils that are located here. And then you can just add that criterion, or add that one to it. You can add some additional criteria by hitting the add criterion, and then you just add below. One thing that I found was a little hard was that my rubric has some headings. So, for example, one that I want to create for spring is that when students in pharmacy document the care they provide for students, they use a specific format called a soap note. And so each of the S, O, A, and P of the soap note has different headings. So you really can't have a heading, so like, here's the heading, here are the criteria underneath it. Here's the heading, the criteria underneath it. It's just all of the different criteria. So from an organizational standpoint, there's no really way to divide things up from like the student perspective. So you would have to provide a little bit more education in advance about, you know, what is the structure of your rubric, what are those headings, because it won't be, it's not able to set that up that way in the rubric, as far as what I've been able to find. Some other things that, just to know, oh yeah.
So what does the larger description allow then? Could you do it in that?
Or? So what the larger description is just saying that, so if you wanted to do, you could just do this being like, this is the subjective portion of your soap note. That's what the S stands for. And then every little thing underneath it. But then that doesn't allow you to comment on the 10 items underneath it. So it's all kind of in there. So basically what this would be is that in the lab, but from a professionalism rubric, you should treat others with respect. So you should communicate well with others, you know, respect others, whatever is underneath there. So that's just more of like for your information purposes. It's not a way to comment directly on something or even provide feedback on something. Okay. So it's just kind of in order to make that description of the criterion a little bit longer.
Okay. Because most of the time they'll be doing the criterion kind of collect statement, the shorter description.
Yeah, this description
just say
here.
Professionalism or subject bill.
Whatever your criterion
is.
If
you want more information, you click here.
If you want more information on what's all included in this, then you could. So you would just add the criterion until you have the number that you want, edit it as you need to. A couple other things is that on this middle box here, it says use this rubric for assignment grading. I didn't know what that meant initially when I used it. And so I would have to use the rubric. I would click view rubric. I'd assign the grade to the student. But then the actual grade never filled in for the student. And so if you don't check this button, you have to manually not only click the rubric grading, but then enter the grading for the student. Whereas if you use this rubric for assignment grading, you click on the rubric grade and it automatically fills in the assignment grade for you. So it's kind of a, it saves you a step, but you need to make sure that you do check that. I'm not quite sure, I've never used the highest score total for the assessment results. That's, I don't think it's always been there. And then the free form is also, the free form comments when assessing students, that's new within the last few months. And I can show you what that is, what I found anyways on the Canvas website about what that means, because I have never done that. So when you're done, all you have to do is hit create rubric and your rubric is created. So one other thing I wanted to mention is, so let's say you have multiple assignments all using the same rubric. All you need to do is go to add a rubric, and then in the upper right hand corner there's the find rubric. It has a little spyglass there. What you'll do is you click on that, you can find your rubric, and then add it to your assignment. So you don't have to create it multiple times. So once you've created it once, it's kind of that one and done type of thing.
Just throw it out there, because a faculty member ran into this, so the second checkbox down there about using the rubric for assignment grading. So what that means is when you're going through the rubric and you're giving this, the criterion points, they got 3 for this one, 5 for this one, 5 for this one, 4 for this one. If you have that turned on, Canvas Auto calculates that subtotal and plumps it into the grade for that assignment, which is that's what's said there. But the catch that he discovered is if you've already graded 1 for an assignment, you can't go back and change this. He got stuck. He didn't quite realize what was happening, so he had already done it 1 time. By that point, it was too late. He couldn't fix it. He didn't know that feature was there, so he had to go back and then manually do the math on all of those for assignments. So
that's good to know.
Be aware of that.
And you can't make any changes to the rubric once you've started using it, right?
No.
I didn't test anything else, but it would probably make sense.
No, I tried to make some changes to it. So once you started grading it, you can't change it.
Is it the starting of the first grade, or is it connected to a due date?
I tried to bring up a view of something and I had to edit it. It's like, well, you've used this already, you can't edit it unless you want to make a brand new rubric for the assignment. So it's when I get that language, I get really cautious about it. I don't want to break it. And of course, that's already
yeah, that's right.
So you do have to be really cautious once you've started using it not to edit it. Yeah.
Question about the points. So let's say you have a rubric and you have 20 criteria and each worth 1 point. But the grade item is that this rubric is based on is only worth 5 points or something. How are the grades set and how are they exported to grade book? So if you have 20 points there, you have 20 criteria each worth 1 point, so it's 20 points total. Is that how many points that item is worth in the grade book?
That's how I've used it
okay.
So far.
Right.
I think if you wanted it, like let's say there's 20 points and you only want it to be worth 10 points, then what I would do is make each item a half of a point
okay.
then.
Right, so if you're grading on a point system, not like a weighted
mm-hmm.
value system, it's all points, so you have to be careful on how much each of the criteria are worth.
That's
no, you don't have to.
You don't have to.
If you have an assignment and it's actually worth 5 points, you could make the rubric out of whatever.
Okay.
That's the beauty of that second checkbox, is whatever percent of points they
so it's percentage of points.
So
okay.
Both, yeah.
All right, so when it's grading the assignments, it's going as a percentage of the points you have there.
Yep.
And then it translates into how many points that
yeah.
item is worth.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you could have the assignment be worth 5, the rubric is worth 100.
Okay. It just calculates out a percentage. So
yeah. That is confusing for students, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, oh, I'm sure. I just want to.
Points.
Yeah.
Right.
Sure.
Yeah. And the ones that I
had
have always been equal.
They've always been equal, yeah.
Okay, cool. I have a question
yeah.
about that second checkbox. When would you not want that check?
That was exactly my question, because when I discovered this, I should put that in as a request. Like, can you at least default back
yeah.
and check yes? And,
yeah.
It's not. That's not the default, though.
No, it's
like,
not.
You need to know
it's
to
not.
Check that.
And it's been 6 or 7 months, so I've forgotten what the response was, but I got like 3 responses real quick saying, oh, I do that all. I hardly ever wanted to do that. I'm using the rubric to sort of let me capture my thoughts, but I still want to have the subjective power to go back in and get whatever grade I want.
Yeah, I guess you're getting like letter grades per assignment.
Yeah, so what it is just interesting. Like, I was expecting everybody to come to my defense and say, yeah, I'm just doing things. But right away, I got 3 kickbacks. I'll see if I can find where to get those out.
Always have that on?
Yeah, I always have that on, because if you're going to use the rubric, then you want it, and it's all equaling out, then you just want it to automatically fill it for you. Otherwise, it's an extra step. So I don't know why you wouldn't want
to. Subjective element. You did a great job, but I don't like you.
Yeah.
So we, All right, so I have some example rubrics where I have run into difficulty. And so as I mentioned before, we have a lot of assignments that are credit or no credit, but yet I want to provide students some additional feedback. And so in my courses, what we do is that we have a scale, so as you can see here, credit and no credit, but some other kind of, some other headers you have that you see here is exemplary, so you did a really good job, but it's not going to give you any extra points, but I want to give you that pat on the back for doing that really good job. A late assignment, or, and we do allow students to resubmit. So what I wanted to do with the rubric is that credit is really, to my mind, the same as exemplary as far as the grade, so they work the exact same number of points. We ask a student to resubmit, they haven't completed the assignment, so really that's the same as no credit until you go and resubmit. So I wanted both no credit and resubmit with changes to equal 0 points, and I wanted credit and exemplary to equal 4 points. Well, you can't do that with a rubric. Everything has to be different. Otherwise, it gets really, really funny, and it looks like the students have no idea what grade they're getting, so you can't have two of the different ratings with the same heading. And so what we had to do to work around the system is that you have to use decimal points, which is really confusing for students, so you really have to explain this in advance. So we use exemplary as like 4.1 points or 4.01 points. You have to use it at least far enough that it's not going to affect the student's overall course grade. Everything that we do in the course is based on full points. So if they got a 92.1, I know that they got a 92 in the course. So that's just kind of our course grading. You would want to go out to the 100th if you did think it might have an impact on the course grade. So what I had to do is create exemplary and credit with the decimal points, so 4 and then 4.1, and then resubmit with changes and no credit with 0 and then 0.1. So once again, students get really confused if you're going to be doing this, so that's something that in their first day of class and then maybe even in the course syllabus that you really explain this, because otherwise they just get confused. And it's like, why didn't I get that extra 4.1 point? You know, that 0.1 point, even though it has no impact on the grade and it's not going to change the grade they get in the course. Another, so this is kind of one thing that I've run into as far as a challenge. This is another rubric that we do in the School of Pharmacy, and I just wanted to mention a couple of things here. The one thing is that the rubrics, if they have different amounts, so you don't always have to have everything be equal. So nothing, it doesn't always have to use the same headings. And so you can see it doesn't always line up exactly depending upon what you have in there. So 4 points may not line up the entire way down. So your graders do have to be really cautious when they are grading just because things may not line up. The other thing I want to mention is that there is a new range function, so it doesn't have to be exactly 4 points. You can use like greater than 0 to 4 points, and then you can use that and then add it in. So there is a range function. I haven't used it personally, but I know some of my colleagues have. But the main reason I wanted to show this is that it doesn't necessarily always line up, and then you have the range function. So again, I don't have personal experience with this, but it is something there. You can see they did use the longer description to describe more about this, so they used a very short criterion and then the longer description below that.
Can you do more than tenths of points? Can you do hundredths of points?
Yeah, I've done it for that exemplary.
For that exemplary thing,
yeah.
I'm thinking that would be, otherwise that tenth of a point is going to eventually add up and affect the grade.
And for us, it's not, we don't have very many assignments with it, and we don't use partial points any other way. So for us, it doesn't make that big of a difference, but I have started using that hundredth of a point, so students, it's a little less impact if you want it towards their course grade.
I love that idea of that pat on the back, though, because it's a mm-hmm. it's more meaningful than a grade sometimes.
It is, yeah, and we want to provide them that feedback, and it was the one way that we could use the rubric for grading purposes, but then also make sure, you know, not we want to use a rubric, but also use what we wanted to for grading. Mm-hmm. So this is just an example on how to grade using the rubric. So what you would do is you would click on View Rubric, and then you would, this would pop up, and you can actually click on whatever you want to grade the student as. So here I gave them credit, it highlights it. This one is green, it kind of shows a little yellow here, but each one has a different color, so if I would click on no credit, it might be red or whatever color that Canvas decided to assign to that. If you do want to provide additional comments to the students, you can by clicking the little green comment button underneath the point. So this would be right here. And then.
That's a free form comments?
And then, no, it's not. So then you could do that, the little comment, and that's available for every single line of criterion that you have. And then this box pops up, and then you type your comments in there, and then you hit update comments. The tricky part is that it doesn't really show very well in, like, in the instructor view on what those comments are until everything is done grading. So it's a little bit, it's not as clear as what I would like it to be. And then once you're done, you just hit save, and then that's how you save the grade.
Is the student in some way flagged that there's an additional comment?
I can show you what it looks like from the student perspective, because
okay.
I had questions about that.
Yeah.
But they are, what they'll know is that they can, in the gradebook, they can click on a little rubric button, and I'll show you what it looks like for the student.
Okay.
And then it pops up, and actually all of the criteria are listed, the kind of what they were graded, and then the comments are right in there.
Oh,
so
okay.
The students can see it directly from the gradebook and with those comments.
When you would use the range function, does it mean that you have freedom to choose any number in, from within that range instead of the one point that would come up automatically?
That's my understanding, and I have not used it personally because my assignments don't have that range. But to me, that's kind of what you can do, is you could pick any point value in between there. I'm not sure how you would go in and assign that grade, because I have, like I said, I don't have experience with that. But
so it would be kind of bypassing option two of, you know, what we discussed previously there. You know, like, but you know, like, what, so that when you click on it, it automatically gets added into the gradebook. You bypass that feature for one particular criterion of a rubric.
Well, I'm guessing what it does is that it probably, whatever number that you put in there, would use that to add towards the total grade. But like I said, I don't have experience with it, but. It would require a little bit more testing on my end for sure. But this is how the grading, for me, the additional comments for that criterion is a little awkward. It's not the easiest, it's just not very easy to see as far as compared to the other comments version that we talked about before as far as grading. Yeah.
I was just testing out this stuff. It's just really interesting to kind of play with this. And I know CAMS is updated every 2 or 3 weeks, right? I think, you know, you're talking about, you could have a same ratings that were the same. I think they changed that, because I have ratings that I accidentally put them in, and they're the same. So I have 2 5-point ones, 2 0-point ones. So I just in case you have.
Sometimes it allows you to do that, but then when you actually go to grade a student,
there you
it
go.
Like, it doesn't, it kind of puts everything together. Or it like chooses one. Like if I wanted exemplary, it would just default to credit.
Oh, okay. So what you
so
see.
So I had trouble, that was back in like August, September when I was doing this. So it's, I don't know if it's
that's
fixed.
Cool. No,
it could definitely be fixed. That was our workaround though, for how to figure out how to be able to have exemplary in our.
So what you see in like the rubric editor is not necessarily what you're going to be getting on the front end when you're doing the grading and using the
there was a we did this also last year, and last year that's it also did that, kind of we weren't able to do it. But then this year, there was something else that, like, it's changed a couple of times.
Sure.
But
cool.
That was our workaround. They may have come up with a way to change it. Like you said, it's always changing,
yeah.
And I'm like, oh, there's a new feature I didn't know about. So it may have changed since we've done the course.
Cool. Thank you for
So this is, I've mainly been talking about just using rubrics in assignments. I also use rubrics in discussions. And so it's to access the, so once you have everything all set up, in order to access the rubric for grading, so you have the discussion here, and then you have all of the student posts below. Underneath each student, there'll be a little bit of that kind of that settings wheel. You can say access SpeedGrader through the student. It gets a little strange to kind of do that. And so the best way, if you're going to be using rubrics through a discussion form, is to access it on the very top. So you go into the discussion, and then up here, the settings wheel, SpeedGrader there. That's the easiest way to access it. Like I said, it just gets a little tricky, or it's a little difficult to use. when you just go into that each individual student. So that would open up SpeedGrader. And then how it works is that, so let's say you have, in our course, we have three students assigned to a group, and then they reflect on their experience with, this is something that is for the course that I teach, that the students go outside of our school and they interact with others in the community. And so for this one, what they do is, there's three students, all students need to respond to this reflection. So we do need to grade every single student that to make sure that they completed their reflection. So I go into SpeedGrader, I open it up, and it'll be just, it'll show one student, but it does allow you in SpeedGrader to expand it to see all of the different all of the different students if you want to. So you can just see one student's work, or you can see everyone in the group's work, all in SpeedGrader. So it's a nice way to kind of see everything all at once if you want to see how the students commented and responded back and forth to each other. And then it's the same of going into the viewing rubric and grading it that way. So you can use rubrics to grade discussion posts if you would like. The only kind of difficulty is that in SpeedGrader, everything is divided by section. And for us, we have groups of three students. So I have 24 students in a discussion, but I only have three students in my group. So when it comes to grading, it can be difficult to be, I have to have a list of, okay, here are all my groups, and manually go in and kind of figure things out. So it's somewhat difficult to go from student to student in that group in SpeedGrader just because of everyone. I have a list of 24 students when I really only want three. It is possible to do that though. You can also use rubrics and quizzes. This isn't something that I have done personally, but others at the School of Pharmacy have done. So what you do is that you, I guess the reason why you'd want to use it is to have more structured feedback in addition to the comments. So each quiz question does have an area for comments, but if you wanted to provide more structured feedback or more routine feedback, you could. In order to access it, you would go through the top of the quiz and you would hit the settings wheel and hit show rubric. And then that would allow the rubric to be, you would add a, that's how you can add the rubric or you can assign it. So the way that we've used it in pharmacy is that, so let's say you have a 15-point quiz for question 9, you want to use a rubric to grade it, and you would just say in your criterion question number 9, and then that's how you would grade it for that question. So let's say you had an essay-based question that you wanted to use a rubric for. So you can use that. The only difficulty is the score doesn't automatically transfer into the grade as it would have for some of the other assignments, but as far as I'm told, there is a new quiz tool that will be coming sometime in the near future. I'm not sure what will happen, but yes, I said sometime. Hopefully sometime in the near future. It might be coming. But it is possible to do that. Once again, I have not grown a personal experience with it, but others in pharmacy have used that for quizzes.
So the structure of the rubric in a quiz is not bound or constrained by the questions within the quiz. You literally can build this rubric independent of whether it matches up or not, you definitely have control.
Yeah.
I don't know that I've ever known or thought or asked or pursued.
I hadn't either, and I was talking with the director of IIT at the School of Pharmacy, Mike Pitterly, and he had mentioned that he's like, oh, we're using this in one of the courses, and I was like, oh, I never even thought to use a rubric in a quiz. So it is a function that you can do, and it is, the setup will be the same, but you just have to kind of figure out how you would fit that into your quiz. But I think for essay-based questions, it'd be really helpful. Mm-hmm. Right, so this is experience. This is also, this is directly copied from the web, but the new free form on how it might work is that it basically what it has is, it looks like this, and then you would add in comments, and then you could add the number of points. So I think it gives you a little bit more flexibility, maybe, for some of those assignments. So it allows you to freeform in your feedback and then freeform in the points, but it gives you a way to kind of break down an assignment. So I'm guessing more for written assignments, this might be helpful.
Is the freeform, is that all or nothing? Can you have some criteria in freeform, some criteria in non-freeform, or is it a...
I'm not sure on that. I have not used it personally. But I was, when I saw that box, I was like, I should probably know what a free-form comment is. So in preparation for today, I found out what that free-form kind of option is. Me doing that.
Yeah, in my experience, when you click that, if you have gone through and created a bunch of different points and you've created this rubric, once you click freeform, that just all goes away. It just goes away.
For all criteria.
For all, yeah, for all criteria.
You can't mm-hmm. have some.
Yeah.
But then, well, the nice thing that it did is it looks like it actually allows you to save some of the feedback that you have, and it creates a drop-down box for you. So let's say you have common feedback that you want to provide. If you're always saying the same thing, that might be helpful from a rubric standpoint. And this just, I think, recently came out, but for me, I'm like, whoa, I would definitely use that in place of other rubrics that I'm using or the ones that I'm going to create for spring semester.
Yeah.
So we just have a thing on Moodle Feedback Manager that they said, hey, we have all of these this, and we can't do it in Canvas. How do we do this in Canvas? Right. We did not know.
I'm going to test this one out just to see. Because if it's just
I haven't tested
it. If you can like, truly manage that list, and like you pre-create it or you can go edit it, that's great. If it literally just like remembers.
Just in this rubric.
Just in this rubric. Oh, that's a good point, too. Yeah, it's stored beyond rubrics.
Yeah, that's been my experience, that it's specific to that rubric. You have to create it. It creates as you create it.
Of course you
do. So you type the thing in, you tell it to save, but then if you use the rubric again, those comments don't follow.
Oh, so if you copy the rubric, it won't. Those comments won't stay.
That was my experience, but Canvas keeps updating, so you never know.
At least within, while you're grading the same assignment 50 times for your students, you might get some repetitiveness there.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Do you know if you have multiple graders? If one is it grader specific versus an assignment specific?
I would assume that any instructor would be able to access the previous grade if multiple people doing it.
But
if an instructor comes in as instructor, it wouldn't be
attached to the person.
Attached to the person's account, I think. These are good questions. And these are questions I'm taking them down right now.
That's right.
And we're going to figure it out and search these things and explore them, because next week on the activity sheet, we're going to have how to do all of these things. So,
keep on going.
So, as far as rubrics in Canvas, you can mute them in the grade book. Like, once the grade is there, you can mute them. Once you unmute the assignment, it releases the grades to the students. So, if you don't want students to see the feedback you are providing, make sure just to mute it in advance. Many of you probably know about this feature already. And students do receive an email that the assignment was unmuted and then can receive their feedback. At the beginning of the semester, I received some questions from students, though, is how can I see the feedback in the course? Like, how do I know that you provided me feedback on this assignment? And so this is also an image directly from the internet, so publicly available. But this is an example gradebook, and this is not from UW, so ours looks slightly different, but somewhat the same. So for rubric feedback, so let's say you use a rubric for assignment one, there would be this little like rubric icon there, and what you would do is they would just click on that, and then the assignment, it would like open up and expand, and they would see all of your criteria, what they received for that, and that's where they would see your comments. So they can see it directly in the gradebook that way. If you leave a comment, and that's in that additional comments area, that actually they can see directly from the gradebook as well. And so if you go to the assignment and then there's this little comment box, ours looks slightly different and for UW, but they open that up and then their comment is listed right there. So they can see that. They don't even have to go into the assignment to see it. They can see their comments right there. Now, if you were to leave comments on that Word document with the highlights and the bullets, there is no indication from the student perspective that you did that unless you go into the assignment. And so the students won't know that you left any of that feedback at all unless you leave an additional comment or use a rubric and saying that please see the assignment for direct feedback on your work. The only way for them to see it is if you click on the assignment and then it'll say view feedback, there'll be another link, and then they'll click on that link and then go into the assignment. So otherwise students won't know that you've given any feedback in that way. We provided, at the beginning of the semester, one of the first weeks, we provided extensive feedback for students. And I was getting all these questions, like, why did I get full points for this? Where did I lose points? I'm like, we left you like 15 comments on your assignment. What, you know, and why aren't you seeing this? And so then I found this out, and I was like, oh, it looks like I didn't realize how they were receiving their feedback and where they could actually do it. So then for me, this was really helpful. Once again, it looks slightly different for our students, but it is, I think, important.
Features are less helpful if you can't see them.
Yeah. So I had a student bring her laptop in, I sat down, and then I made this slide for all of our students in the class, so they knew exactly what to do. The other thing I just wanted to mention, and this is not necessarily rubric specific, but just a helpful hint, is that when you use the comments section for assignments, and once again, this is just a comment that's available out there, is that we use this to provide feedback to students, but students can also make comments to you on it. And it says, this language has changed multiple times over the last 2 years, but it says teachers and submitter will be notified of all comments. Well, unless you have the notification turned on in Canvas, you actually will not receive any comments that students leave for you. So I found that because of that language, students were using this to communicate with us about grades on their assignments. So if you leave feedback through the rubric, or just points, or however you're leaving feedback, is that they'll be like, well, why did I lose 2 points? Or this, where they would historically have emailed us about it, they were using this. And so actually in our course syllabus and in our introduction to the course now, I provide the fact that we will not be monitoring this, because there's two ways to receive notifications from Canvas. One is to receive a notification with every comment, which some are, I submitted this assignment, or here is my assignment, which I don't want to see those. That's a waste of my time.
Got it in under time.
Yes, you did it. But as far as the, so you can receive, there's two different ways you can do notifications. One is an email of every single comment. The other one is a daily notification. So the nice thing with the one email per comment is that you can see the comment directly, so I can easily just delete those, here's my assignment ones. If you receive a daily digest of your comments, you actually have to click on the link to go into the assignment to view the comment. So for me, it was really overwhelming to receive all of these comments on the assignment. So just so that you're aware of that it's in there, if you need, whether or not you want to turn notifications on or not. I currently have them on so I don't miss anything, but I've told students I don't monitor it just because it is something that I don't want to receive a gazillion comments, and it's really not easy to track in communications back and forth either. So just more of a FYI that I've run into this problem.
So John, in your recommendations to Canvas, because I know you talk to those people more than me, maybe suggest that you have some options for what you're notified on, so that you are notified, so you can choose, I want to be notified everything submitted, I want to be notified when comments are posted, you know, and you can choose between those.
So under your account settings, you've got already about 128 gajillion different options.
Oh.
So you're asking for 129th one to be added.
Okay.
And then
it's a good point, but this should be like inbox, right? This is where I think that should get sent to you.
And it's not, though. If it
right.
doesn't go to your inbox, and for some things, it's like, well, thank you for taking the time to grade my assignment. Well, I hope I see that, too, because it's like that, you know, pat on the back that we don't necessarily always get.
Exemplary.
But it's well, why didn't I get full points for this? And those are historically things that we get as email messages, but students are using it as a means of communicating back and forth.
Soon we'll have an artificial intelligence that will be like, send me all the good messages.
You know, we know, right, that the inbox may not be based on your notification, but it can be pushed out to your email. I thought you were saying that you turned off that, but are you saying you don't even get the inbox message? You don't get the message in your Canvas inbox?
No, the way that it is setting is that you can turn on notifications for this, and
but
you can
that pushes to your email.
To your
that
email,
to
yeah.
But I would assume.
And so you can get 10 emails a day, depending. I mean, I'm in 4 or 5 different courses a semester, and the number of students making comments can overwhelm your inbox.
Sure.
Things you may not need.
I just didn't know. I just assumed that. Yeah. So that really means you would need to go to this comment, like the
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the only option is submission comments right now. So, but that is anything that they said.
But just more of a word of caution that I did not have it turned on initially, and then realized I was missing a lot of things, so turned it on and then became overwhelmed. out. And then education was provided to students about this, like, we're not going to be monitoring this, please don't use this, but they still do use it because it says, I'm going to be notified. And Canvas has changed this language a couple of times. For a while, they took off the just, instead of teachers and submitter will be notified, that was just add a comment, it was blank after that. But this semester, it is now back again, where it says that we will be notified. I just wanted to provide that more as like an FYI, because it was a, regardless of what grading method you're using, it can be something that catches you. That was all that I had about rubrics. Is there anything else that we want to talk about today? Any questions you had about rubrics?
Have you done peer grading with rubrics?
I have not done peer grading with rubrics. We have students do peer grading in our course, but we actually use Google Docs for it. So that's how we use it and provide feedback. And they just get credit for completing it. It's not, they use a specific rubric for it.
How many of you use rubrics? Any other hints that you can give us on rubrics, experiences that you found useful or terrible?
Oh, I just thought of one.
Excellent. Andrea.
So let's say I have a professionalism rubric and it's 15 points. Most of the students every week get 15 points. So you can use the rubric if you want to, but if they got 100% on everything, you can also just go in and give them the full 15 points. You don't have to use the rubric. So that's been kind of helpful, is that sometimes I just go in and give them 15 points because they got all the points, they know that their grade is yes for everything. And it's been more, it's an easier way to manage grading, especially if you have the majority of students completing all of the different items in your rubric.
And you can just do that in the grade book, but then give everybody full points, and then go back in and say, oh, Tom wasn't here today, so he doesn't get those.
Yeah, the only difficulty with that is that a student this semester was like, well, initially you gave me full credit for it, and then you went back in, and I didn't get full credit for it.
Yeah.
And so, why didn't, I got notified twice, like, why did my grade change? And I said, well, did you go take a look at your feedback comments? Oh, no, I didn't take a look at that. So even if you go ahead and do that, it is, students are notified twice, and there can be some confusion on, I got full points initially, why didn't I get it?
That's interesting. You guys know about like muting your assignments?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if it's muted, they just get one.
You wait till the very end, so you could mute it, do it, and come back with a change.
And I've only had to change like one or two students, and
sure.
I wasn't like thinking about like, oh, I'm going to mute this assignment, then unmute
that's
it. So, like, so you might want to, that's a great point of muting and unmuting.
I use rubrics, but paper rubrics back in the day. And, And,
those pencils?
Yeah, this is number two. I used the rubric, and I was like, you know, this is genius, I'm really being good. But then my students would go back and they would look at their criteria, and they're like, very like diligent, like, well, what does this criteria mean? And how is this different from this criteria? And I had to have like a really good answer to like what these things were, because sometimes you just put them on, they sound nice. Their criteria. That's my only really, really thing with rubrics that I always remember that stuck in my mind. It's like each criteria should have a really clear delineation between that criteria A and criteria B, and criteria C should be different, and there should be a good explanation for why they're different. And so that was my big thing on rubrics. This is, you basically ask her.
The more detail you give, the more you better be ready to.
Yeah.
It's almost like a law, right? Or a legal document where if there is a loophole, they will go in and look for it and try to find it.
Yeah.
But as a student, I would have done that, right?
Absolutely.
But at the same time, if you make it very clear from the beginning, they know what your expectations are and they can achieve to whatever level they want to. So
I think just my only recommendation is just think, go through, make your rubric criteria, but then think again about what these mean, because sometimes on Tuesday it sounds really good, and on Wednesday it's like, it just sounds pedantic. So,
They're really hard to write.
Yes,
they
are hard to write.
I was also thinking about that rubrics is one of the four ways when you go look at like extra credit options within Canvas and the help material, the rubrics is one of the tools for delivering that. If you did not know that, you can put 5 points, but you can get 6 points. So. Mm. That all up and down the deal. So,
Have you ever had your students help create a rubric?
I have not. I've been always the one to create it because we use it standard across multiple courses for the ones that I'm involved with. So I have not used them. Use students to help create one.
Has anyone here done that? I think in different disciplines it would work and others it would not work. I guess I'm thinking of that sort of course expectations, or how are we going to, maybe for discussions it would be good, and like, all right, students, what is a good discussion? And if it comes from them, they have more ownership in what the criteria are. But I don't know, maybe.
I could see them choosing the criteria, but clearly defining what is expected within that criteria, that's hard for somebody who's trained to do. I don't know if students could define them so much as choose what the criteria are.
Well, and even having them choose a criteria gives them some sense of ownership.
Right. Oh,
and
yeah,
then,
definitely.
Like, okay, what does that mean? I will tell you what it means in this profession.
Mm-hmm.
Because you don't know, but I've been in this profession, so I can help you with that.
Right.
And it helps them sort of start to think about, well, is my behavior, is my level of skill, is my whatever, up at that level, what does that mean?
We spot grade lab activities, and I've had students suggest, please don't grade this one. Because it's really hard, and they just don't want to be graded by it, because it could have 50 questions, and it's spot grade 5. So that's a bit of a co-conspirator, students as co-conspirators, but also, please don't grade me.
But also, you don't have, like, you spot grade, but you've pre-chosen which of those 5 are, so you don't, it's too bad. I mean, if they say, please don't grade this one, that's one of the 5 that we're grading this week.
Yeah, yeah. But it's difficult with the rubric, though, because you can't hide a rubric. Right? So we have to create the rubric after, because it's not so much a rubric as a guide.
Say more on this, because I think this is brilliant, and we could all benefit from this.
Okay, so grading lab activities, we've had 4 TAs in the past and 120 students, and we big, thick lab activity, grade, spot grade 5, we create a rubric after they turn it in to identify the 5 questions that we want to grade and then do a low, medium, high point system.
5 questions out of approximately how many would you say?
200.
5 out of 200?
Yeah, with sub-questions, yeah.
Okay.
Yes, more on
that. In one activity, 200 questions?
In the beefier ones, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
so if you had created that rubric for those 5 questions ahead of time,
students
could just go
it.
Up there and say, oh, here's the rubric.
Yep.
I'm going to check this out. And, oh, it looks like I only have to answer number 17, number 25, and number, 48.
We do look through the rest of their lab and make sure they're not just scribbling a line. But the one workaround we've seen for that is just unpublishing the assignment, and then the rubric along with that gets unpublished. But if you mute it, students can still see everything about the assignment, they just can't see the grade for it. So it's not really a rubric, but it's more of a speed grader tool. For one hand, you're flipping through a lab activity, and the other, you're clicking the box, and then it sums it, and then you just machine it down. Yeah.
And you're moving.
Yeah, we figured out the ergonomics of, like, don't write anything on the lab manual. Everybody's right-handed on it hurts, right? So,
did you learn the criteria?
Yeah.
And you guys are also moving all of that paper-based manual into Canvas as well, or Google Docs?
Probably Box
first.
And then embedded the folder in the box. So then they'll upload a document that'll go into the doc viewer. So then we can free up my left hand, and I'll just scroll through their.
Other hesitations about rubrics?
They take a while to make.
Yeah.
It's like the call clicking.
To kind of piggyback off of what Lane was saying about being really thoughtful about your rubric, number of points, I think, when you're creating your rubric, it kind of helps you think about how many points you want a certain assignment to be. You know, I made a rookie mistake when I first started teaching of making a paper worth like 50 points. What's the difference between like a 31 and a 32? You know, like what really, when you get into those high numbers with paper grading especially, it makes it kind of difficult. So I don't know if anyone else has any thoughts or experiences on that.
This is why I like letter grades.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's,
yeah.
I know what the difference between an A paper and a B paper is, but I'm not sure I know the difference between a 94 and a 92-ish, you know. It gets harder the more points.
Yeah, and like a low AB and a high AB could make the difference between like an A or an AB in your final grade, so depending on how many points, yeah.
So the, along those lines, I used to do a scale to 5, and I've switched that to being to 4 because I found myself too often just going straight to the middle. And
yeah.
By doing 4, it forces me to decide, are they more on the low end or more on the high end? You have to really think about what's in there.
Ultimately good or ultimately not good.
Right. Which end are they on? It's too easy to, if you've got an odd number, it's too easy to just go to the middle. It's like choosing C on a multiple choice every time.
Mm-hmm.
All right, well, if you have any other questions or insights or aha moments about rubrics before next week, shoot us an email and we'll try to address them or figure out a way to address them next week at our 100th lab. And we're gonna have cake, that's already ordered.
And eat it too.
With 100
candles. So, I mean, unfortunately,
if you get to blow them all,
building policy doesn't let us have live flames in the building. Otherwise,
do it outside.
Yeah. Please help me thank Andrew here for sharing with us today.